Good afternoon, friends. Good afternoon, friends. Yeah, I think this financial sector has got so much importance. So every speaker on the dais till now has one way or other referred financial sector. Some bank or some financial transactions or some frauds or some cyber attacks or some ATMs, some e-banking, something like that. So you can very well imagine how important this sector has become and how vulnerable this sector has become, where all your role comes in the way. So as far as this financial sector as such is concerned, you can think that it's not only banks. It's banks, small payment banks which have come very recently, public sector banks, RRBs, insurance sector, and whatnot. And even nowadays, it is not only transactions only happening, even loan syndication, loan origination, and credit appraisal, and whatnot. All sort of things are happening. Then you must have heard of SWIFT fraud, which happened in Bangladesh. It also happened in Union Bank in India also. Then, other than that, recent 2-3 days back, you must be hearing big news is coming in newspapers about ATM frauds in Calcutta. So this put together, it makes entire banking sector, entire finance sector so vulnerable that we have to think of that how to protect our infrastructure and everything. It's not only banking now. In earlier days also, even before digitization and everything, banks, because we deal in money, and always as Mr. Pandey, IPS, he was referring, whenever money is there, means you can very well expect frauds, crimes, and all that. So banks were used to all these things, but they were protecting in different way. Now somehow, when we have come to digitized world, where we have all transactions are becoming digitized, our infrastructure, total digital infrastructure is there, and people are not doing fraud sitting in the bank, sitting in one particular country or one particular location. They are doing sitting across the world. Like my friend was referring to a fraud happening in London and Europe, and people were sitting in India. So in IT and digitized worlds, we think that there has been a lot of outsourcing of work to different organizations. There are many people involved in these transactions. So we'll have our panel on some discussions on that, so that we can see whether the dependency of outsourcing has increased and the cyber risk has increased or what. Then there are alternative delivery channels, ATMs, e-banking, mobile banking, and now wallets. All companies, many companies, many banks, they have come for wallets where lot of frauds have happened. Then why actually, if you think why actually frauds happen, is it because of our inefficiency or our unawareness, or it is because criminals or fraudsters are more intelligent? I don't know, means we have to think on. Like my friend was saying that daily thousands of new viruses are coming. Antivirus persons are developing all antiviruses daily basis, updating on daily basis, they are releasing signatures on daily basis, but during a day, they are releasing signatures 3 times. So how fast other side is working? That is also very important. And there are also frameworks prepared by different organizations, like for financial sector, RBI has given frameworks. But unless we follow that, unless entire ecosystem follows that, it is not going to help. Any loophole in one of the ecosystem's part may create havoc in entire ecosystem. So with this, I think we have a very learned panel here, and I'll introduce and we'll discuss on how we are going to fight these cyber attacks, what should be roadmap for future financial sector for stopping or at least minimizing cyber attacks on that. So with me, towards my right side, is Mr. Tathagata Datta. He's CISO of Srei, and also he's heading IT governance functions. Please have a big round of applause for him. See, Mr. Tathagata Datta has experience of IT governance, IT functions, and infrastructure and cybersecurity functions for more than 18 years. He's a specialist in process consulting, cyber incident handling, and digital forensic analyst. So I'll just first introduce all the panelists, and then I'll start with Mr. Tathagata. Then my left side, Mr. Varghese is there. He's business head east of Jana Small Finance Bank. So please welcome him. He's MBA from XLRI. Before joining Jana Bank, he worked in HSBC and GE Capital. So he has experience of a big bank and big NBFC. So I think Mr. Varghese will be in a position to say how his experience is there. Then to my left, just left, Mr. Nabankur is there. Please welcome him. He's advisor cybersecurity in Bandhan Bank. Everyone knows Bandhan Bank. It's from Calcutta only, and now it's a big bank. And before even joining Bandhan Bank, Mr. Sen has worked in many organizations, and last he retired from Axis Bank. So he has a thorough knowledge of, he has been in this field for last 40 years or more, I think, plus 40 plus years. Then towards my left, Mr. Gauri Prasad Sharma is there. He is GM IT of United Bank. Please welcome him. He too has around say 35 years of banking experience. He has worked in IT, he has worked in cybersecurity, he has worked in banking, he has been branch manager, zonal manager of a big public sector bank. So we will have public sector perspective also. So then my right, Mr. Roopen Shah. Mr. Roopen Shah is AGM IT in Arohan Financial Services. Please welcome him. So it is typically a fintech company having microfinance, and I was just asking before this, their portfolio is not very small, it's a big portfolio, and he has a lot of experience in this field. So I think now everybody is aware of, yeah. So what I'll start with Mr. Nabankur Sen. Sir, first thing is because you have been working in big banks, all tech savvy banks, and banks where they are aware of entire cybersecurity framework and cybersecurity environment altogether. You have been working for around 40 years in this field. So I would just like to hear from you regarding your present cybersecurity's present scenario, whatever challenges are there, and what are the important aspects of cyber threats and cyber security in just all organizations like banking, particularly with reference to, I will say, e-banking, mobile banking, ATMs. We would like to hear from you.
Thank you. Yeah, I have a lot of experience in 40 years. I was in information technology, pure IT, for about 20 years. And after that, about more than 22 years now, I am in IT security handling. Earlier, I was with State Bank of India. And then 9 years, I worked with Axis Bank, retired from there as Chief Information Security Officer. And I am in the field of information security even after my retirement 5 years back. So cybersecurity actually is, growing, and it is evolving continuously, as all of you know. Every day we have to be up to date on what is happening entire world, how the indicators of compromise are arriving, and then we have to analyze them and prevent the attacks from happening in our organizations. So basically what Mr. Chhattani was asking about various threats, I would like to start with the only one issue which has been happening in Aadhaar area. all of you know that in UIDAI, Mr. R.S. Sharma, he tweeted his Aadhaar number and then everything, all hell broke loose, that whether it has been, Aadhaar has been breached or not, and whether the information has been extracted from other sources or not. So you see the biometric data in Aadhaar is the most important thing which has been preserved, but it is not enough. There are so much of other personal data which is stored with Aadhaar and various other organizations in the country. For example, in my organization, my personal data is maintained. My name, address, my phone number, and so many other information. Every organization will have to be 100% accurate in providing complete secrecy about the personal data security. It is not only that Aadhaar will have to be responsible for everything. Aadhaar is excellent initiative by the government to provide an identity to each individual of the country. We have to support that. There were weaknesses. The weaknesses are being controlled, and it is being strengthened day by day. And thanks to all the criticism which is coming against Aadhaar, the system is becoming stronger. And you know, today also there was a news in Times of India that in your mobile phones, which is linked with Aadhaar, if you just go through the contact list, you will find a contact called UIDAI. You have not created it. You just check it out afterwards, not now. I checked myself and I got it. Yes, in my phone also there is a UIDAI contact. I have not saved it. So it is pushed from the backside. It is pushed from the service provider. So your mobile phones, as our chief guest was talking in the morning, that the mobile phones are also vulnerable. See, if somebody can push the data to your phone, they can extract data from your phone also. There are methods available. We have to be extremely careful in handling mobiles, in our handling computers. So what we have to, I do not want to take too much time in the beginning, although there are so many speakers. I want to emphasize on two things. One is that for the roadmap, in future roadmap, what is the topic of the day, organizations will have to play a major role in securing the data, in securing the entire systems. When internet banking, mobile banking is used by the customers, we have to see that their credentials are properly preserved and they can do the banking in a safe manner. Their authentication has to be 100% accurate. If there is a phishing attempt, the phishing monitoring services which we have in our bank, in all the banks, in previous banks also, we have phishing monitoring services. We know that if somebody is getting phished, immediately we try to block the phishing site, which is a fake site. And we try to help the customers to see that they are not duped. But from the other side, from the customer side also, a lot of awareness will have to be built. We are trying to give awareness as much as possible by way of sending SMS, by sending bulletins, and we have sent do's and don'ts list to each branch, which is pasted for the customers, just to read about 15 points. Because Bandhan Bank is a rural intensive bank, we have sent in vernacular language also in Bengali and Hindi. We have sent the bulletins to each branch for the customers to see. Customers have to just pay a little attention in how they use the computers, how they use internet banking and mobile banking. And that little bit awareness is sufficient. Like what happened in the ATMs, skimming attacks, it is not a new thing. We have seen a lot of skimming attacks in past also, in Axis Bank also it has happened. And it has happened in a prominent place in Colaba, where Chief Police Commissioner's office, there was an ATM in front of Police Commissioner's office. Both sides there were guards with rifles standing. And in between those Belgian people, two foreigners came. They installed the skimmers and the camera, and they left. After 15 days, they came back, removed the things, and then there was a cooling period of about 2 months. After 2 months, the transaction started flowing from Greece, from another country, from another region. And when the customers complained, immediately we blocked the transactions from Greece, and then it stopped. But by that time, a lot of money had gone. We immediately reimbursed all the customers, and then found out that particular branch. We went through the CCTV footage and found out that that particular ATM was compromised. Now here, there are a lot of guidelines came from RBI. They have given the anti-skimming solutions are possible, very expensive. So whether the banks can afford or how to do it, the banks have written back to Reserve Bank saying the cost. But only one tip I can give for the customers and for the general people is that when you enter the PIN number, just cover the PIN pad with your left hand or one hand and type your PIN with the other hand. Just protect your PIN from being exposed to any camera, whether it is a small camera which is fixed in front of the PIN pad or it is in the ceiling, it doesn't matter. If you cover your, while entering the PIN, not only in ATMs, even in the shopping malls, when you go and give your card to Spencer or any marketing person, any the billing counter, you give your card. When you enter the password or PIN, you please cover it with one hand and enter the password with another hand. If this much is done, no skimming attack will be successful. I'm telling you, because if the card information is cloned, that does not contain the CVV number, which is there in the back, that does not contain the PIN number, which is there with your position. So the track to information which is cloned and copied by someone will be useless if the PIN number is not obtained. So this small information, if you can spread to everybody, that PIN number, you, when you are entering, please be careful. That will go a long way. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Sen. I think he has given a very good look out of what to do to protect our transactions. Yeah, I'll be coming with the questions in the end. I think we should not, let us complete this, then we'll come for the questions. Then it's a good that he has very clearly said how important is Aadhaar and where we are to give, where not to give, and how important is our ATM infrastructure, how to protect that. And one thing, one important thing is, unless we go for customer education, we go for our staff education, digital literacy is more important than any other thing. Yeah, I'll move to Mr. Tathagata. Sir, as you are working in Srei, and I think we have seen a lot of outsourcing in the field of IT and so many activities in the banks and NBFCs and everywhere. Do you think that outsourcing has opened up threat to cyber security? And if yes, how to protect this? What is your weight on this? And how you think that in future we should go ahead for that? Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chhattani, for asking a very pertinent question in today's business scenario. In today's business case, we all are moving towards an OPEX-based operations. So it is not possible for every business house to run the entire gamut of business activity by their own. So we are bound to outsource. Now, while outsourcing some of the services, the primary thing is whether we are assessing the risk, inherent risk of outsourcing that particular service. How critical that service is to my business. A very basic, you know, kind of example I can give. If you send your kid to a crèche, will you be rest assured that as you are sending your kid to a crèche, it is their responsibility to take care of your kid? Or you'll be, you know, very much cautious and be, you know, be watchful and take care of every aspect of their activity. So in business, data is like the heart of everything, the crown jewel. So when we are allowing the third party or the fourth party and so on to deal with our data, our information, which is critical to my business, there should be some due diligences. So government has come up with some framework or master directions. RBI last year has released a master direction for all BFSI domains. In their mandate also, they have specifically asked for certain check and balance, maybe in point number 7. So whenever we are outsourcing some of the business, we have to see whether the capability of that particular partner, we should not say them as a vendor, we should be treated them as a partner, because until and unless they put their skin in my business, the engagement model will not be that. We need to marry, because until and unless they put their skin in the business, they won't be in a position to feel that the kind of loss the organization may suffer in case of any cyber outage. So due diligence not in the form of name of the company. The primary mistake that we do while selecting a vendor or a partner, we look at the cost part only. Go for the low cost service provider. And this is the first step where we normally go wrong. So the second part, we only look at the big names. But if you look at the big names, they also outsource their businesses to some small houses. Maybe they are beyond the boundary of our legal jurisdiction of our country. Now, there is a term called plausible deniability, which enables any foreign country to say, if identified that some of your information theft has been originated from their jurisdiction, they just directly can't take any action. The statement they normally do make is, yes, I have received your complaint, we'll do our due diligence or investigation as per our own law, etc. And if we find them responsible, then we'll get back to you. In 2012, there was a first major attack happened on DRDO servers. India's investigated and shared all the information to one of our northern neighbor. They said, okay, it is reported, we'll investigate and get back. And the result was zero, though the evidences were provided. So instead of looking for big brands only, if we can focus on the small SMEs who are more innovative, more focused to the business, they are also very much keen to grow by offering good services. Those things can be evaluated when you are outsourcing the business, number one. And secondly, while outsourcing a business, just without going by the statement given by them, if you also check at their contingency plan and ensure a good security governance on their activity, that may save us from, you know, from many of cyber attacks. That's all from me.
Yeah, thank you, Tathagata. As you said, rightly said, if we are outsourcing, it should not be only consideration of big names or money. That is the main thing. And RBI, yes, for financial sector, RBI has given very clear guidelines. It's not only today. Some starting guidelines came in some 2013 or somewhere. And again, every year it has to be reviewed and audited. Unless you audit your activities, outsource activities every year, unless you review those activities and see what is happening, what they are doing, and basic control of your critical information should be in the hands of the owner, not the outsourced party. So that is one of the important points you said. Now I'll move to Mr. Varghese. He's working in a fintech, and earlier also he has worked in HSBC and GE Capital. So he has a lot of ideas about how fintech, and you know, fintech means everything digital. Almost everything. So they are dealing with digital world day and night. They are dealing in all processes and everything is digital. So I'll like to have his experience and what he thinks about how we can protect our digital environment from cyber attacks for future.
Sure. Good morning, all of you. This is Clemenston. I'm from Jana Small Finance Bank. You might have not heard this name much. We're just a 15-day-old commercially launched bank. We are one of those youngest banks in the country. We were amongst the 10 small finance banks which were issued license. And we have the second category, that's the payments bank. So we are the small finance bank. So there is a normal notion that people have that this is a small bank. We are not a small bank. We are a small finance bank. So only difference is the finance is small, but the rest of the banking opportunities are still the same, like a normal bank. I'm one of the odd man out in this entire panel because I'm not a techie. Okay, I'm a pure business guy. So my first question to Infocon earlier when I was invited for this conference was, why am I part of this? Because I'm a pure business guy. So they wanted to understand from a business angle in terms of the cybersecurity, what is the kind of influence it would have? And what would we as business leaders look at in terms of when we start the banking operations, the microfinance operations, because we are more of a microfinance organization, which has just got converted as a bank. So just to start off things, I think the biggest weak link anywhere is employees or us, okay? Because if that particular piece is addressed and we have proper well-trained resources, I think the first biggest link is getting resolved. The second important thing that one of our panelists was talking about was in terms of our own security that we keep breaching, in terms of thinking that we take things for granted, saying that, no, I don't think security can be breached against my card, my debit card, my credit card. But, and we tend to be a little careless when we deal with our own personal security. So I think that important tip in terms of securing when you're putting in the punching in the PIN number, I think that's something very fundamental that we need to look at. So I've just classified certain things into some broad five categories. So this is, I'm just informing that this entire piece can be put in 5 points. The first one would be basically in terms of we need to, as an organization, as a bank, as a financial institution, assess our readiness to response and what is our resilience when we face such attacks. Normally, the biggest challenge is we tend to be more reactive, and I think these attacks can be avoided in case we are more proactive in our approach as an organization. So Mr. Tathagata was talking about that organization tends to invest in smaller IT firms so that the cost piece is controlled. I think that's one of the biggest factors that needs to be looked into. The second point is basically to hone some of the critical assets that are there in the organization. So when I say critical assets, I mean you need to identify what are your critical assets and which has value and which does not have value. But what happens is you need to take a look basically at the life cycle of your critical information. As the assets, it depends upon the assets which you consider non-critical might be actually critical for the hacker in terms of whenever he wants to breach anything. The next would be, third point would be in terms of you need to select your own defense. What I mean is, based on the assessment of your critical assets that you have in your organization, you need to select basically the defenses. You need to know what is going, what are you going to defend against, trying to prevent them against all the, because it is impossible for an organization to prevent or secure it from all the exposures, because that is going to be very expensive for the organization. So I think that is very important that we understand what are the important things that we would want to secure. The fourth point would be basically to boost your security awareness and education. Everyone in the organization, because normally right from the boardroom to the mailroom, I would say, the awareness has to be extremely high in terms of security breaches. The trust and understanding the value and sensitivity of the information they possess are actually important, because until unless we are able to do that, we would not be in a situation to protect the information. The last point would be in terms of enhancing the monitoring and incident response. This broadly categorizes from my perspective, from a business angle. So I think the simplest thing that we will all have to do is, Mr. Pandey was talking about it. I think the more we are able to report the incidents, I think the more the awareness that can be created in the market. Because we normally feel that in case I report an incident, I need to go all the way to the bank, I need to go to the police station, report this incident. I think the more the reporting, the more the awareness that is created, I think that would help the entire banking system. Because no one bothers till the money is lost. The moment money is lost, everyone starts wondering, why am I targeted out of all these people? That's it from my side. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Varghese. And Mr. Varghese has said very, very important things. One is criticality of operations, criticality of response. What products, what services there are, which are critical, what assets, critical assets are there, you have to classify and you have to look for those things. Then he also said, what you have, you know. But what you don't have, you don't know. Means my friends are there who are having very good security operations center, very good SOC is there. 5 modules are working. They are monitoring, everything is being done, that's okay. But if one module is not working properly, then you must know what that module is for and how critical that is. And what I'm not getting, actually, alerts, had I been getting from that module, I would have responded to that. So we must know what we don't have and how much that important is. Thank you, Mr. Varghese, and you are not admin out. Actually, I'm also business leader, you are also there. So actually, when we think of financial sector, it's not only IT we are looking for. Anything related to IT is for business development, for business growth. It is not IT for development. Bill Gates are there, HPs and IBMs are there. They are developing IT systems. But we are there in banks for ultimately, even if we are CIO, CISO, whatever, we have to ultimately protect the business. We have to develop the business. So you are not an admin out. You are most welcome here. So friends, now I'll go to Mr. Gauri Prasad Sharma. He is GM IT in United Bank. And Mr. Sharma has worked in all across. He is also a business leader. He has worked as branch head. He has worked as zonal head. He has worked in different departments of head office. He was instrumental in bringing manual things to CBS. So ultimately, things have moved to core banking, and he was instrumental in that. Mr. Sharma, what I like to know, because you are both business as well as IT guy. So like, we are following KYC norms for customers. Whenever customers are coming, whenever transactions are happening, we are following whether that is a genuine customer, where we know the ID, where that is identified customer, his residential proof is there, ID proof is there, everything. But things when come through digital mode, through internet, we don't have any regulation that how to check that, whether we should check at all. We just believe that, okay, it is coming. And many a times we say, okay, this should be a straight through process, STP. And we believe that STP means everything is coming from one system, going to other system, it's fine. But should we have a sort of KYC for those transactions or those incoming things? Please, in addition to whatever your experience is there regarding cyber security and cyber threats in public sector banks, because you are from public sector, so it's different, altogether different game plan. Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chhattani. My experience of public sector bank is almost of 33 years. I'll be completing 33 years this December. Came to the bank as a generalist officer. Later on, I moved to IT. As of now, I'm heading the IT, MIS, and alternate delivery channel departments of United Bank of India, headquartered here at Kolkata. I have seen a lot of transformation as far as adoption of IT in running banks is concerned. Especially in my bank, it has happened with all banks. I joined the bank when things were totally manual. Used to enter transactions in manual ledgers. Since then, so we moved to even computer the very word was not spoken at some point of time in the public sector bank. We used to call them the initial lot of machines that were brought into the banks as advanced ledger posting machines or ALPMs. Thereafter came total branch mechanization. Then we moved to core banking solution. Now CBS has become a history, lot of new things have come in. Mobile banking, internet banking, all other things are there. So now the bank cannot move without IT. Everything is IT driven. So this transformation journey was a unique experience for me. And with this transformation, security threats have also increased over the years. Lot of regulatory directions, government directions have been received, sometimes as reaction to happenings around us. And banks have implemented many solutions, antidotes to all those threats. But in spite of all these things being in place, none of us can say that we are 100% protected, 100% safe. Because, as it was spoken by one of my previous speakers, that the cyber criminals are always one step ahead of us. The village in Jharkhand, which is busy in cheating people, many of you might be knowing, a lot of reports have come in the newspaper and media. Jamtara, I think. Jamtara. So they have also changed their techniques. Initially, they used to ask for your card details and all that. Nowadays, they apply different techniques. New techniques keep on coming. In order to combat all these things, as a GMIT, per day I come across nowadays, not a single day passes without coming across a complaint or case of this nature. Customers being duped or cheated. Techniques are getting changed every day. So the situation is such that we have to remain alert. It is not only alertness or awareness on the part of the customers, it is on the part of the banks. We are alert, the department is alert, but even the last man working in the field, the counterman, he also has to remain abreast of all the developments that are going on, the measures being put in place, and at the same time play a responsibility to make the customer across the counter aware of things. As Sensar was telling, he's a very experienced person, very respected person in this field, that one small care, that put your hand on top of your fingers while keying in your PIN, that itself will save you from this skimming attacks, which is being discussed in the media of late so much. So this is again a part of awareness. Banks do their part. We send SMS, we say do's and don't list. We make our employees aware. But ultimately, if the customer who is using the ATM, he is not aware, then he is likely to fall prey to this kind of attacks or traps. You can even touch the slot in which you put your card. If it is something is loosely fitted on top of it, it will just give away. It will come out. Then you can immediately alert the bank. Or if you find that the PIN pad is something newly has been pasted over it, don't use that ATM. So these are small, small things. But sitting as IT GM of a public sector bank, I come across a lot of cases. Just to give you a brief, a small example, a live example. Yesterday late in the evening, I received an email from a customer that he has paid 10,500 rupees to one of the accounts in my bank. The name of the account is something interesting. It says Indian Friends. And the person who runs runs this particular organization or farm or whatever you call it, he runs a dating site. In the web page, I found that he gave some photographs and one mobile number only, nothing else. Anybody who is attracted, he calls that number, and thereafter all communications happen through WhatsApp messages or chats. And finally, when someone is asked to pay the money, he pays the money, and later on he is duped. Only one customer dared. I found from the total history of transactions, lot many have been duped, but I did not receive even a single complaint. One person complained to the bank that I have lost my money. So reporting, that is very important, which was also discussed. India is a country of under-reporting. Whatever had happened in May 17, ransomware attack and all that, it is not that India was not impacted. As it has been mentioned, that third worst hit country. But how many incidents you could read in the media? Very few, especially for the financial or banking world. One or two cases. That Bangladesh case, Union Bank of India case, and off late the City Union Bank in Chennai, is a private bank, they have been duped by intercepting or rather intruding into the SWIFT system of those banks. So banks are aware, they are aware of, they are concerned about these threats. Integration of SWIFT with core banking, that was again a reactive kind of thing immediately after that PNB incident of Mehul Choksi. But PNB was not a cyber breach. It was the person, the people. It was also discussed in the morning, people, process, and your assets, these are very important. The people who are manning the machines, they are also equally important. So in this scenario, this identity of the persons become very important. When a customer comes, time is very short. When a customer comes, we know him. He's sitting in front of me or standing in front of me. I can check his credentials, his KYC documents, whether these are in order or not. But in the digitized world, when your server is accessed from any place in the globe, it is a connected world. We cannot remain in isolation. So whosoever is coming, he comes from a, you know that he is from a particular IP. But now there are techniques. Probably many of you might be aware that this Tor browser, which gives you the scope to surf the net, remaining anonymous. Now we do not know, except the last exit node point from where it direct accesses your server, only that point is known. Beyond that, it moves through like onion peels, layer after layer, encrypted messages flow through the system. You never know who has actually originated that message. Or that if an attack happens, you never know who is doing it. It is anonymous, everything. So all banks or all financial institutions, we are talking about the Security Operations Center. Now these have been rechristened as Cyber Security Operations Center. I too have one, round-the-clock manned. We analyze everything. Everything is recorded. In spite of all those things, now something is coming from this kind of locations, which are unknown. As my colleague, Mr. Chhattani, was talking about the KYC of those incoming, I mean, whatever you call it, attacks or messages or hits that you are getting. We need to think on that also, how to identify them and bring them down. We have put something in place in my bank. I think many other organizations, everybody are aware of these threats. Certain tools are available, because at the last point, the IP gets dynamically changed. So you can make a pattern of the same, study it, and accordingly bring down those people who are trying to attack your server or reach your server from locations unknown to you. So within this limited time, probably this topic is a very vast one, and probably it requires a detailed presentation also. Since time is limited, I will confine myself here itself. So one thing I can assure you, the audience, the banks, the financial institutions are quite aware of the challenges before them. We are doing our best. We are cooperating with all the agencies, law enforcing agencies also. Mr. Pandey was here with his organization also as a Kolkata headquartered bank. Unofficially also we cooperate. Only yesterday we could nab a person who was actually misusing the name of a e-commerce platform and duping people, sending messages or calling them that you have earned a lottery or you are getting something on discount, you pay this much of money to this particular account. The account is with me. In that account, there is absolutely no problem. It is a KYC compliant account. There are some very poor people also who actually hire out their accounts to these criminals. When we nabbed that person with the help of the police, we could find that in lieu of some small amount of money, he was handing over his KYC compliant account to these fraudsters. So all those these things are there, very much there. It's a kind of tug of war. Some days they will win, some days we will win, we will prevent. So with this I conclude here. It's a very vast subject in limited time probably. It's not possible to cover everything.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sharma. And there are certain, he says his bank has done something, every bank has done something to protect the interest of the customer. Even RBI has come out with customer judicial guidelines, customer compensation guidelines, customer awareness, everything. Even some banks like our bank and other banks are having some mobile app which controls your various ADC channels, alternate delivery channels. So if you want, you can control your card. Whenever you can block your card with in your fingertips. If you want to use it, unblock it, use it, then again block it. So it remains with you always. Similarly for e-banking, mobile banking, these things are there, and many banks have different ways to do that. So for now, I'll go to Mr. Roopen Shah. Mr. Roopen Shah is working with Arohan Financial Services, and he has a lot of experience, around 25 years of experience in security and IT field. So he's typically a non-banking finance company looking for looking after MFIs, microfinance only. But there again, their platform is IT only, digital only. And we'd like to have what is your pain areas in your field, how you perceive for you risk is there, that cyber threats are there, and how you control this. And what you think for future, how as a group of NBFCs and MFIs, how you wish that this roadmap should be prepared in such a way that everyone is secured. Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chhattani. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to InfoSec Foundation and Enterprise IT World for inviting me to share the dais with my esteemed colleagues over here. So I represent Arohan Financial Services. We are a microfinance company. And in the last 1 year, we have almost doubled in size. And we are very much connected with technology. Like all our loan officers use tablets. And we use our loan sourcing software on the tablets. So definitely RBI governs a lot of regulations are there for MFIs also. And we have a cybersecurity response that we have to submit to RBI within 3 hours of finding the response. And I think one of the colleagues was mentioning about that 97% of the incidents are not reported at all. So that is a big challenge. And in microfinance, like over here, one thing about cybersecurity, I'd like to say that it has evolved over the years. We used to talk about antivirus, viruses. There were like maybe a few thousand viruses way back in 20 years back. Now you have around more than a million viruses. You have ransomware, worms. And these things are constantly evolving. And you have two-factor authentication that Mr. Pandey was talking about. Just consider this, you have your smartphone where all the OTPs are coming. Suppose your smartphone gets hacked and you have, let's say, some malware in the smartphone which is able to read your OTP. So it could be that your credit card is being used somewhere and the malware actually reads the OTP and sends it to the server of where the malware is hosted. So you will not even come to know that this credit card has been used for some financial transaction and the money has gone out of your account. So these things, like, we are getting digitized at a very rapid pace, and in spite of this, the awareness of the users is very important, where we have to be aware that, you know, the phone that we have in our hands, it can be hacked within seconds. We should not give the phone to anybody, even for a few seconds, because if it can get hacked, then you, all your data, all your OTPs that come on it, you will not even be aware that it's been misused. So there was one interesting statistic which I just read somewhere that in the last 4 years, 2012, the amount of time it took for a breach to be detected was 416 days. And now the time has come down to 99 days. if some company or some servers are getting hacked, it takes about 99 days on an average now. So this seems as if it's a good statistic, but actually it is not good because the attacks in 2012 were only 6%. That has grown up to 47% now. So that actually is maybe some sort of an idea we can get about how these attacks are increasing day by day and they're getting smarter. We are also getting smarter in the defenses that we are incorporating, but these solutions that we are, some of the solutions are mentioned over here, they don't come cheap. You have FireEye, you have Blue Sapphire, SecureEye. So these solutions, not everybody can afford to install at the enterprise level. They're very expensive. You're spending like almost millions of rupees on a yearly basis to get these solutions in place. So awareness is a very important thing. Basically, we face this challenge in our company that a lot of churning is there at the lower level, the loan officer level. So we train them on what to do, what not to do. And then after a few months, we find that we have to again retrain the new people who have come on board. So that is an ongoing process. That is a thing that we have to fight and challenge. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think he has covered a lot of areas and interesting things. So friends, before we come for question answer session, just I will just sum up in the way that, okay, cyber security, cyber threat, it's universal phenomenon now. It's not for financial sector, it's for everywhere it is there. In financial sector, yes, our stakes are more. We have to be more careful. And like my friend said, we have to be aware of critical infrastructure, critical information, critical responses. And there has to be critical response team everywhere where once you come to know of something, you have to check that, how fast you can control that, how fast you can reduce the losses at least. Like alternate delivery channels, ATMs and everything, frameworks are there, RBI has already stipulated, but unless entire ecosystem works in tandem, it's not going to be of any use. Then every one of us and everyone before this panel also, everyone suggested, this is digital literacy of customers, digital literacy of staff. Let staff be aware of everything, how they are controlling the things. Let customer be aware of that, okay, simply putting a hand on pin pad is going to help you from skimming. Using of mobile apps or some solution for blocking, unblocking the things, it is going to help you. So it is not only persons or processes or technology, it's combination of all those things. Then processes part, I think Mr. Varghese had covered a bit part, but I'll say, like Mr. Gauri Prasad Sharma also said about Nirav Modi and all, okay, these things are maybe criticized, maybe classified as cyber fraud or not, that is a separate thing, but had there been proper processes in place, if some trail is there, if some reporting is there, there is a system of reporting of, say, particular transaction level, above that it is reported to higher authorities. So if had that system been followed, that system had some alert gone to some higher authority, then it would have been possible to stop it earlier level, or at least we could have proved that, okay, everyone was involved. Today it's not only Mr. Shetty or something, it's involved, because we don't have any trail of that. So system has to work like that. It is ecosystem which has to improve, which has to be foolproof. Thank you very much, all the panelists, and I don't know how much time we have, but we can certainly have some question answers. So two questions have come.
Yeah, I've read this. One question has come that when I was talking about covering the pin pad with the hand, somebody has asked that the ATMs and the POS terminals should have a guarding arrangement for preventing copying the pin numbers. Actually, whoever has asked the question, can you raise your hand? Who? Yeah. So it is a very pertinent question. And you know, when we were in Axis, I was in Axis Bank, we had done that. It is called a pin pad shield. Pin pad shields are available. It is very cheap also. it is costing about 200 rupees or 300 rupees, so per ATM. This has to be installed by the ATM vendor, because it has to be installed and it has to be screwed from inside in such a way that the scamster or the fraudster who comes in the ATM room is not able to take it away easily. So that guards the PIN entry. So it is a good suggestion. It should be given to all the banks, and the banks should proactively do that. This is the one solution which you have pointed out is very right. Of course, the customer should be aware that the PIN numbers should not be seen by anybody. But the banks should be also proactively taking up this PIN pad shield. It is not given in any guidelines of RBI, so nobody is doing, as a compliance activity. But it is a good solution to protect the PIN pads in the ATMs. But in the post terminals, giving a PIN pad shield, whether it is possible, I am not aware. I am not. So if no, RBI has not given any directive for PIN pad shield.
I have a suggestion on the same subject.
Yeah, please.
You know, we should enforce password change on a given period of time.
Correct.
I think that is something the bank should immediately
do. You're right. But again, I'm with you only, and we are doing that. We already started that. But only thing is, our rural masses, our semi-urban masses, a lot of customers are there who simply even share the password with their family members, share the password with everybody. So education of customers is more important. Any law we can frame, yes, you are right. If password change is there, naturally chances are less.
I agree with you, sir. I'm saying, you know, it should be periodic.
Yes.
Not only one time.
Yes.
Every 3 months you impose something IT in, you know, we used to do it long time back.
Correct.
I think same thing.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. Perfectly all right. Anyone else? Yeah.
Presently, we are getting like the incident that happened last few days back. It is said that the ATMs are cloning the cards at the insertion point. And also the PIN is getting hacked from the overhead cameras. So how to check these points?
Yeah, this is what we were talking about, that there are the skimmer has got two parts. One is that in the card slot, the skimmer is inserted, and then when the customer goes and inserts the card and then does a transaction, he is not aware that the skimmer has already copied the information. He does his transaction the normal way and goes away. And parallelly, the PIN number is also captured by a camera. They are all interconnected. So the skimmers are actually very cheap. Nowadays, if you go to an online site like Alibaba, even in 800 rupees, it's such a cheap thing, like 800 to 1000 rupees, a skimmer can be purchased. So it is not a very expensive thing. Anybody can, all the fraudsters can do it. Now the skimmer, when it is inserted in the card slot, it is not possible to, in a normal way, it is not possible to view that. But through awareness, you should be able to see if there is something connected. The red lights, which normally blink, they do not blink properly. There are so many indicators are possible, but that needs some awareness as to how this that particular device is attached. And in the TV also, someone has showed, someone was telling that you can just try to see whether there is any loose object in the ATM card slot. But I was told that in Hyderabad, 4 ATMs were damaged because customers were trying to just take away something. So 4 ATMs got damaged. We do not want to do that. Lightly you should check it out. Very lightly you should check it out. Something is fixed in a loose way or not. And as I said, that the PIN should be covered. And as one the gentleman has pointed out, the PIN pad shield is one thing which will be taking care for this.
One more thing I'd like to add to Nabankur, what he said about protecting the card. There are some banks, I don't know about all the banks, but like HDFC Bank, they have online protection. Yeah. I'm just adding to what you add, what you said, how to protect your cards from skimming. So what Mr. Pandey said, that the card was used in maybe Greece or Belgium, somewhere else outside India, after a couple of months. Some banks have a facility where online and net banking, you can go and lock your debit card, ATM card, so that it cannot be used outside of India. You can lock it from your net banking.
I said we have that solution. I can show you, in mobile app is there. You can block international transaction, you can block POS transaction, you can block e-commerce transaction, you can block even your normal transactions. So that is totally blocked, and at the time of use you can unblock it. So those things are there, very, very much there. Yeah, please.
I have a simple question. I mean, do bank have established procedure for checking physically the ATMs of those, presence of those schemers?
Yeah, banks have got a system of sending the engineers to every ATM on a monthly basis, but that is not on a daily basis. It cannot be done.
No, but you do replenish the cash. I think once
that is a different thing. Cash replenishment agencies, they are not engineers to check out a skimming device.
No, moreover, cash replenishment is not done only by banks. It is through agencies also.
Get the pin from the camera, which is fitted under over the keypad. So why not use a touchscreen keyboard?
See, it is not the camera fitted over that. It is miscreants who fit the camera in such a way that even you, if you touch that this thing, that is recorded and they get it.
And it is
not
screen.
Yeah.
On the screen where the instructions come.
Some ATMs are coming with the touchscreen now. We have in India, we have around 2 lakh ATMs. And you must have heard, even many ATMs are working on Windows XP, which, yeah, that's what he's saying. So it involves a huge cost. Now RBI has come out with control measures. There are 11 things which are to be implemented in every ATM. And you know the cost? It will be in thousands of crores for entire banking industry. Yes, we have to do it. I don't say that we should compromise security for the cost. But it will take time also.
Actually, the vendors of ATM like NCR Corporation or Diebold or Wincor, these people have to come give a lot of solution for this skimming. Actually, the anti-skimming solution should be built in. It should be a part of the ATMs. Why it is not given and then they sell it separately? It should be a part. The government has to discuss with them and make it mandatory for the ATMs to have an anti-skimming solution right there. Even touchscreen, which you are saying, if the pin pad entry has to be changed, and it has to be given a touchscreen, the vendors will have to do it, the NCR Corporation or Diebold and all. We cannot, it will take a long time. We do not have control over the vendors. So,
again, this anti-skimming devices I was talking about, there is a direction from Reserve Bank of India that all ATMs must be equipped with anti-skimming devices. How does it work? Even if the skimmer is fitted there, when you insert the card, there is a jitter movement. The card is jittered in such a way that the image captured is of no use. So these things, every ATM will have to be changed. So physically someone will have to go, and it involves a lot of cost.
Now at least, whatever new ATMs come, now since RBI has issued the guidelines and control measures, now whatever ATMs will come with all those features.
Yeah.
And earlier ATMs, we had to do in phased manner. It is a timeline given by RBI, and everybody, either they will replace the ATMs or get it correct. So that is going to happen.
So there was another question here, actually, in the paper it was written about our banks. Are our banks secure, having secured internet? At least the biggest bank of our country, you cannot access to other website. So I think he has asked a question about internet banking. Now,
they are using the internet. It is only secured line. They can't go to any website through that. He can send the email, he can get the email, but not any website. So it's about, I don't know what percentage, a good percentage is protected. So I'm not sure about other bank, but the biggest bank is having such system. Other banks, I would like to know on this issue.
No, all banks are having. Most of the banks are having. It is a internet is secured. When you go to visit the bank's website, that sbi.co.in or SBI online SBI or axisbank.com, they are all secured. If you see, when you give that particular URL, www, it will come in a green color. That green color indicates that you have reached the correct proper site. But that is not how the customers are duped. Customers are duped not by the genuine sites. Customers are duped through the fake sites. When you are receiving a phishing mail and you are clicking on the link and the link opens a particular bank's site, it look-alike site, it does not mean it's a genuine site. So when you have reached the phishing site and you have given your credentials, that is fished out. So if you give the proper URL, type it and go to the genuine site of the bank, you will never be phished.
Just to add on, as the threat dynamic is changing very fastly, the security mechanisms are also evolving. We can't expect that everything will be in place in one point of time. So threat is changing, our combating mechanisms are also changing day by day. And in this context, as we are discussing in the initial phase, that most of the services now we are outsourcing, I think the procurement function of any financial institution need to be more educated and aligned with all the regulations and the mandate released by RBIs. So in most of the cases, they play the key role in this function. So
I think there have been very lively discussion, and we should not come in the way of our discussion and lunch. So we should break here. I thank my all panelists. It has been very lively discussions. I thank our participants who participated through questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, gentlemen, for organizing such an important panel discussion. I would like to invite Mr. Sanjay Mohapatra to kindly felicitate Mr. R.K. Chhattani for moderating this panel discussion. Can we have a huge round of applause? Thank you so much. Now I would request Mr. R.K. Chhattani to kindly present the token of appreciations to all the panelists. Can we have a huge round of applause for all our distinguished dignitaries?